Saying, Brother Moole, do you believe Ted Wilson is a Jesuit? I can hear some of you asking this even now. No. I do not believe that our General Conference President Ted Wilson is any Jesuit. I believe he's hamstrung. I believe he's run up against the real movers and shakers in this church. And it is going to take God himself if Ted Wilson's wishes for the great controversy are to prevail. Here's why I don't believe he orchestrated this scam. Number one, I believe his zeal in announcing this project was genuine. I heard him in Atlanta after he was elected. I may not be the best judge of character. God knows I've made my mistakes in judging people. But I believe he was genuine then in Atlanta. And I believe he's genuine now. He's making some serious mistakes, but I believe he's genuine. Even before he was elected president in Atlanta, when I met with him in Silver Spring 2 weeks before his election, he discussed what was at the time Jack Henderson's project up to distribute a great controversy across every zip code in America. You could see the zeal in the man's eyes and hear it in his voice. He meant it. He wanted this book distributed and probably had not thought that it would be railroaded by this piece of trash, The Great Hope. All right? Number one is subjective. It is my assessment of the man. I do not believe he was being false then in calling for the distribution of the great controversy. Two, in this meeting at Silver Spring, when I asked him a very pointed question, which I'll get into later, his answer was, Brother Moole, there are some things about our church that I don't like either. But there is no king at the General Conference. This church is run by committee. That's almost a direct quote. I believe he's up against people and committees that hate the great controversy. He's just not willing to go public with it. And it's going to come back to bite him, for I believe criminal charges could be filed as a result of this scam. Three, Silver Spring. Now, I didn't see this for myself. I'm taking the word of somebody who is closely connected with what was going on at the General Conference. We do have friends who will tip us off from time to time. I like to confirm stories when having at least two people tell me. Well, this time I'm dependent on one. And he tells a story of a particular meeting at the General Conference in which Elder Ted Wilson challenged the workers to support this zip code distribution of the great controversy, the zip code of Silver Spring, Maryland. They needed, I think the person said to me, close to $30,000 to cover it, and they raised closer to $60,000 that day. Ted Wilson was one of four or five people who forked out $1,000 of his own money to raise it, okay? They raised the money from the workers at the General Conference. In other words, not church money, but regular workers like you and I reaching into their pockets and saying, this is a darn good idea, we're going to support it. All right? Now, I haven't checked in the past 3 months, but I know like 3 years have gone and the book still has not been shipped out. If it has been shipped out, it's within the past 3 months. Ted Wilson raised the money and couldn't get the book shipped to the zip code that he wanted sponsored. Now, what does that tell you? If our General Conference president can come up against a buzzsaw that sharp, what is that saying? It's telling us something about the power of the movers and shakers behind the scenes. Now, we have been made to understand that there is some hospital the church is trying to build up there, and they didn't want to flood the zip code with great controversy for fear of a backlash. They felt it more important to try and get the hospital going. That's what we were told. That's what my contact told me. And I quizzed him left, right, upside down. He stuck with his story. David, I'm telling you what I know. Elder Wilson was one of either four or five people that reached in his pocket. Now, the whole thing could have been a charade, but I don't believe so. I believe the man was genuine when he reached in his pocket and wrote that check for the $1,000 and contributed it for that. That's the president of our general conference, and not even he can get the book distributed. Number four, the inroads of Catholicism. These are the reasons why I tell you I do not believe Ted Wilson orchestrated this scam. The inroads of Catholicism didn't begin with Ted Wilson. What has gone on with our church hymnal took place in 1985. B.B. Beach presented the Pope with a medal in 1976. And even before that, in a 1974-1975 lawsuit in which Ted's father represented the North American division, the following was entered as evidence. And this was... It didn't come from Neil Wilson's lips, but I'll tell you about that in a minute. But it was entered as evidence in the lawsuit. Quote, although it, and this is the top, this is the leadership of the Seventh-day Adventist Church entering a document in a court of the United States, okay? Although it is true that there was a period in the life of the Seventh-day Adventist Church when the denomination took a distinctly anti-Roman Catholic viewpoint, that attitude on the church's part was nothing more than a manifestation of widespread anti-popery among conservative Protestant denominations in the early part of this century, that was the 20th, and the latter part of the last, and which has now been consigned to the historical trash heap as far as the Seventh-day Adventist Church is concerned. That's Neil C. Wilson, past president of the Seventh-day Adventist General Conference, father of Ted Wilson, in a court transcript of the United States versus the Seventh-day Adventist Church, Equal Employment Opportunity Commission versus the Pacific Press Publishing Association, etc., etc., etc. Now, years after this, I was accosted by one of the General Conference's lawyers in an elevator in San Francisco. There was another lawsuit going on, and I wanted to be there myself to hear some of the pleadings for myself. And coming down that elevator, the lawyer did not like the fact that in Indianapolis in 1990, we had distributed a copy of the transcript that I just quoted to you on the streets of Indiana. He didn't like it. And he threatened me. His tone was not nice. I would be hearing from them, he assured me. And he went on to say that Elder Wilson never uttered that statement. He said it was uttered by Elder Wilson's lawyers. Well, I'm happy for that distinction coming from one of the lawyers of the General Conference. At least now we know. But if it was entered as evidence in a lawsuit by the leader, or representing the NAD, Neil C. Wilson, the time to have challenged it, the time to have repudiated it, was in that courtroom, not in an elevator with me and trying to convince me that Neil Wilson didn't do it. It was entered by his lawyers. The man should have at least read it because it was coming out under his name. One of the reasons why Winston Churchill is such a hero to me is that he saw the enemy long before most. His peers didn't seem to see that enemy. At least, they didn't take him seriously enough until it was almost too late. But not so Churchill. He saw Hitler for who he was and warned and warned and warned. The British Parliament didn't care much for his saber rattling, or as some called it, Winston's warmongering. One such speech delivered before the House of Commons was given on the 24th of March, 1938. Listen to Churchill try to rouse his country. This is what he said. For 5 years, I have talked to the House on these matters, not with very great success. I have watched this famous island descending incontinently, fecklessly, the stairway which leads to a dark gulf. It is a fine, broad stairway at the beginning. But after a bit, the carpet ends. A little farther on, there are only flagstones. And a little farther on still, these break beneath your feet. Look back upon the last 5 years, since Germany began to rearm in earnest and openly to seek revenge. Historians 1,000 years hence will still be baffled by the mystery of our affairs. They will never understand how it was that a victorious nation, with everything in hand, suffered themselves to be brought low and to cast away all that they had gained by measureless sacrifice and absolute victory. Gone with the wind. Now the victors are the vanquished, and those who threw down their arms in the field and sued for an armistice are striding on to world mastery. That is the position. That is the terrible transformation that has taken place bit by bit. End. Later that same year, when Germany seemed poised to annex part of Czechoslovakia known as the Sudetenland, Britain's Prime Minister Neville Chamberlain seemed finally to be waking out of sleep and hastily flew to Munich to meet with Hitler and negotiators from France and Italy in an attempt to stave off war. You can see him on the screen behind me as he returned holding a piece of paper bearing Hitler's signature and joyfully declaring peace in our time. Chamberlain was terribly wrong. He had woefully underestimated Hitler. Historians, not the least of which was Churchill himself, would see to it that Chamberlain would go down in history as being not merely Britain's prime minister at the time, but her prime appeaser as well. To be sure, Churchill made fun of cowards, at one time referring to one of his opponents as a sheep in sheep's clothing. The moral of the story? Instead of scrambling around pleading for peace, Chamberlain should have been doing precisely what Churchill had been urging for years, preparing his country for war, building his war machine, more ships, more submarines, more aircraft and tanks. Churchill hadn't been urging anything new. It was George Washington who said, "To be prepared for war is one of the most effective means of preserving peace." It wasn't exactly a novel idea to either man, but in speech after speech, article after article, Churchill hammered it home relentlessly. So why have I taken you back to World War II, to British Prime Minister Neville Chamberlain, and to that worthless piece of paper in his hands? Because the Seventh-day Adventist Church is making the same mistake. You see that graphic on your screen? The Pope is Paul VI. The other person is Bert Beverly Beach, who at the time was Secretary of the Northern Europe West Africa Division of Seventh-day Adventists. On May 18, 1977, Brother Beach had an audience with the Pope, during which he presented the Pope with a gift from the Seventh-day Adventist Church, a gold-covered medallion. You may call it Bert Beach's piece of paper, and on it, if you look hard enough, are the signatures of the leadership of the entire Seventh-day Adventist Church at the time. For surely he dared not give that medal without consulting the General Conference itself. What does that medal represent? In light of events that have unfolded since it was awarded, events that we will get to before this series has concluded, that medal, I believe, is the pledge of the Seventh-day Adventist Church to remain silent while the papacy rearms, to look the other way while all the world wanders after the beast. You may have seen pictures of the medal, but there's nothing quite like holding one in your hands. Go ahead, take a look at it. I'll have the camera zoom in as tight as I can for you. Heads or tails? Take your pick. Either way, it's an abomination. No matter the lofty ecumenical goals Bert Beach might have had as secretary of the Conference of General Secretaries of the Christian World Communion, that's the ecumenical group to which he belonged, what is the man doing? He knows he's dealing with the Antichrist power. What is he doing giving the head of that power a gold-covered medal, one that was probably purchased with your tithe? The replica in my hands is probably made out of brass or some alloy. At any rate, sometime before the 1990 General Conference session in Indiana, we found out who minted it and ordered maybe 50 or 100 of them, which we then sold to Seventh-day Adventists so that they could see for themselves how far our church had fallen. We have none for sale now. In fact, this is about the only copy I could find. But in its continuing failure to denounce the awarding of this medal, you couldn't want any more evidence to prove that the leadership of this church has fallen into the same trap into which British Prime Minister Neville Chamberlain fell. In spite of the blood-curdling history of the Roman Catholic Church, her crusades, her horrible tortures, the millions upon millions slaughtered, the Inquisition, the Armada, the St. Bartholomew's Day Massacre, and yes, the Holocaust, which, God sparing my life, I'll get to one day in a full-length video. It seems as though we think that by being nice, by being gentlemanly, by sticking our heads in the sand and pretending we don't see what we do see, that we can somehow forestall the inevitable Holocaust awaiting us as Revelation 12:17 unfolds. Because there are those watching us right now who don't know this passage, or those who might want to pretend it doesn't exist, it might be well for us to read it again. Let's go to our Bibles. Revelation 12, verse 17. And the dragon was wroth with the woman, and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. Who is the dragon? According to Revelation 12:9, it is the devil or Satan. And who is the woman? Over and over again, the scriptures use the metaphor of a woman to describe the church. Here is Paul in 2 Corinthians 11:2. For I am jealous over you with godly jealousy. For I have espoused you to one husband that I may present you as a chaste virgin to Christ. In Paul's eyes, the church in Corinth was as a chaste virgin. So what is this verse, Revelation 12:17, predicting? Satan will wage war upon the remnant of the woman's seed. Put another way, we could say the remnant. That's the last remaining vestige of the church. The church that will be around at the second coming of Christ will be the special object of Satan's wrath. And how is this remnant defined? There are two identifying marks in the Bible, and only two. First, according to Revelation 12:17, they keep the commandments of God. That's the Ten Commandments given by God to Moses. Not the Ten Commandments as adulterated by the church, but the Ten Commandments given by God, the one which includes the Sabbath commandment, which reads, "Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. In it thou shalt not do any work, thou nor thy son nor thy daughter, thy manservant nor thy maidservant nor thy cattle, nor thy stranger that is within thy gates. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that in them is, and rested the seventh day. Wherefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it." The other identifying mark in this verse, the identifying mark of the remnant, is this: they have the testimony of Jesus Christ, which Revelation 19:10 tells us is the spirit of prophecy. Come, let's read it together. "And I fell at his feet to worship him. And he said unto me, See thou do it not. I am thy fellow servant, and of thy brethren that have the testimony of Jesus. Worship God, for the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy." Transpose that definition to Revelation 12:17, and how does it now read? "And the dragon," that's Satan or the devil, "was wroth with the woman," that's the church, "and went to make war with the remnant of her seed," or the last generation of Christians, "which keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ, which is the spirit of prophecy." The remnant church keep the commandments of God, not man. And they possess the gift of prophecy. And Satan is going to wage war against her. And the agency through whom he has worked for 2,000 years, pagan Rome in the time of Christ, and papal Rome through the Dark Ages, the Crusades, the Inquisition, and the Holocaust. Like it or not, according to Revelation 13, we will not be able to buy or sell. Not clothes, not food, not water. Every avenue of human support will be cut off before Christ returns. Some of us not fortunate enough to have found refuge in the hills will be hunted like dogs and slaughtered, just as happened to the Waldenses, Albigenses, Protestants, and Jews when the Catholic Church, for all intents and purposes, ruled the old world. If you doubt that some of us are going to die in this war, then maybe we'd best turn to Revelation chapter 20 and verse 4. There John writes, "And I saw thrones, and they sat upon them, and judgment was given unto them. And I saw the souls of them that were beheaded for the witness of Jesus, and for the word of God, and which had not worshipped the beast, neither his image, neither had received his mark upon their foreheads or in their hands, and they lived and reigned with Christ 1,000 years. Beloved, those of us who have studied prophecy know that this new entity, the image to the beast, which resembles the beast but isn't the beast, is a new religious power. Absent during the Dark Ages and the Reformation, this new religious power, according to the prophetic interpretation given by the author of this book, who, by the way, gave numerous evidences of being especially blessed with the prophetic gift. This new religious power isn't developed until the apostate Protestant churches in the United States succeed in getting the government to do two things. Let me repeat. The image to the beast isn't formed until two things happen, according to the author of this book. And she says, when they happen, look out. First, the government must sustain the institutions of the church. That's give them money. And secondly, the government must enforce the decrees of the church. When that happens, the image to the beast will have been formed. Under President Bush II, the United States of America came close to fulfilling this prophecy with coupons that enable state funding of students attending religious schools. That's the transfer of state funds to religious schools, which ought never to have been permitted under the First Amendment of our Constitution. But thus far, I don't think we've seen the government fulfill the other requirement, which is the enforcing of the church's decrees. The breach in the First Amendment hasn't gone all the way, but we're oh so close. When the breach is complete, the image to the beast in this country will be fully formed. And what decrees will the government enforce? In an attempt to rein in immorality, I can see the church issuing several decrees. No doubt there will be some against abortion, some against homosexual marriage. According to this prophecy, the mark of the beast prophecy, Sunday worship will be at the heart of them all. You want to catch a glimpse of what's coming? Then notice what John does. In Revelation 24, he puts the multitudes who were beheaded for the witness of Jesus. No doubt these are the 50 to 100 million heretics slaughtered by the Roman Catholic Church during the Dark Ages. In the same class as the remnant who worship not the beast nor his image, the implication is clear. The punishment meted out against the heretics in the Dark Ages will be meted out against us. Whether it will be beheading or other forms of execution, it will be a death decree before all this is over. In interpreting Revelation 13, which deals with the image to the beast and the mark of the beast, here is what Mrs. White predicts on page 580 of this book. Marvelous in her shrewdness and cunning is the Roman Church. She can read what is to be. She bides her time, seeing that the Protestant churches are paying her homage in their acceptance of the false Sabbath, and that they are preparing to enforce it by the very means which she herself employed in bygone days. Those who reject the light of truth will yet seek the aid of this self-styled infallible power to exalt an institution that originated with her. When she speaks about an institution that originated with the papacy, Mrs. White is referring to Sunday, by the way, which the Roman Catholic Church boasts is the mark or sign of her authority. How readily she will come to the help of Protestants in this work of exalting Sunday, it is not difficult to conjecture. Who understands better than the papal leaders how to deal with those who are disobedient to the church? And again, on pages 615 and 616, she writes this. As the Sabbath has become the special point of controversy throughout Christendom, And religious and secular authorities have combined to enforce the observance of the Sunday. The persistent refusal of a small minority to yield to the popular demand will make them objects of universal execration. It will be urged that the few who stand in opposition to an institution of the church and a law of the state ought not to be tolerated, that it is better for them to suffer than for whole nations to be thrown into confusion and lawlessness. The same argument, many centuries ago, was brought against Christ by the rulers of the people. It is expedient for us, said the wily Caiaphas, that one man should die for the people and that the whole nation perish not. This argument will appear conclusive, and a decree will finally be issued against those who hallow the Sabbath of the fourth commandment, denouncing them as deserving of the severest punishment and giving the people liberty after a certain time to put them to death. Romanism in the old world and apostate Protestantism in the new will pursue a similar course towards those who honor all the divine precepts. The people of God will then be plunged into those scenes of affliction and distress described by the prophet as the time of Jacob's trouble. Thus saith the Lord, we have heard a voice of trembling, of fear, and not of peace. All faces are turned into paleness. Alas, for the day is great, so that none is like it. It is even the time of Jacob's trouble, but he shall be saved out of it. That's Jeremiah 35:7. You would think that every Seventh-day Adventist, including Burt Beach, would know these things. In fact, I'm sure he does. But a job has been done on him and on us. There are different ranks of intelligence at play here, I'm sure. But it's the same devil who lays his traps for the intellectually sophisticated as well as for the fool. Neville Chamberlain was no fool. Still, he was deluded and traveled to Munich to do something which can only be described as kissing Hitler's, well, let me not use the word that comes immediately to mind, because Jesus never used slang. I think it's best just to say Chamberlain traveled to Munich to kiss Hitler's gluteus maximus. You go look it up. And that is precisely what Burt Beach has done with the medal given to Pope Paul VI. And that is what he's doing in this photo with Pope John Paul II. He and his ilk need to be reminded of Churchill's description of the path inevitably trod by the appeaser. Quote, it is a fine, broad stairway at the beginning, Brother Beach. But after a bit, the carpet ends. A little farther on, there are only flagstones. And a little farther on, still these break beneath your feet. You know something? I wonder how many new converts to God's church know these things. How many know these prophecies? How many know about this medal in my hand? How many know the significance of the three wavy lines that make up the church's new logo? I don't know what those wavy lines mean, but I know that in the early 1990s, I listened to a sermon at Prophecy Countdown that was preached by Bob Treffs. He actually was able to project on the screen the frequent use of these three wavy lines on Jesuit documents. Today, I went looking, and these were the ones I found. Do you think that it is by accident that our church's logo was changed from something looking like this to this? I ask the question, how many new converts know these things? But it could equally well be asked of our older members too. How many of our old members, those who have spent 20, 30, 40, 50 years in the church, know these things? I suspect very few. That's why we're showing it here. That's why we're repeating these prophecies here and in our videos. That's why we're shouting at the top of our lungs that there is something dastardly, something ugly, something treasonous and truly wicked that is happening at the top of this church. Giving the Pope a medal was bad enough. Polluting the Seventh-day Adventist church hymnal with Catholic hymns and sentiments should have told us where we were headed. The three wavy lines hinted at who was really running this church, but gutting the great controversy, stripping it of Luther and the Antichrist and all that is inimical to the Roman Catholic Church, and giving the masses this piece of fraud instead, for me, that's the last straw. tricking the masses with this book certainly won't change the prophecies of the Bible. Many of us will still be slaughtered at the hands of the religious coalition being formed before our eyes. Do you honestly think Pope Francis's appeal to Kenneth Copeland and the charismatic wing of the church is a joke? Ecumenism, with all its deformities, with all that it portends for the people of God, is here to stay. Friend, there's a lot that we'd like to do while we still have the time. The coming slaughter of Seventh-day Adventists need not be as widespread as the General Conference. By her treachery, is ensuring that it will be. We can still rise up and put more submarines in the water, more aircraft in the air, more soldiers on the ground, more warnings in the media. For one, we'd like to continue producing video clips just like this one that you've just watched. But as I said, video costs money, serious money. I'm in the midst of recording this appeal just now, so I don't know how much our final bill would be, but you can count on us having to spend at least $1,000 before this appeal will have been finally edited. And by that, I'm referring just to this section dealing with Churchill and Hitler and Burnt Beach. That's $1,000 spent before you saw any of this. If you like what you see here and at our website, www.lrltv.org, and if you'd like to see more, maybe as much as one new video per month, then I invite you to partner with us. Help us lift our voices as much as we can to warn not merely Seventh-day Adventists about the ongoing treason taking place in our church, but help us warn the world about what is coming, what is right around the corner. As I've said before, your gift doesn't have to be large. 1,000 people giving $25 per month would help us immensely. Some of you can give more, a lot more. Whatever God lays upon your heart, don't hesitate to give it. Well, that's all for me today. Churchill, Hitler, Chamberlain, Burnt Beach. May we learn the lessons of history before it is too late. Won't you partner with us as we go forward? One new video per month at our website. With your help, I know we can do it.